Hey, how's it going everyone? I'm Mike Pointer, and earlier this year I made a video covering graphical tricks on the Sega Mega Drive, or Genesis, but there was one thing I didn't cover in much detail, and that was the console's mysterious shadow and highlight mode. I only briefly mentioned it at the time because I was planning on doing a follow-up video at some point dedicated to this special feature, as just like the Super Nintendo's transparency effects, it's not a topic I feel could have been covered in enough detail as part of another video. So now it's time to examine this little used function of Sega's hardware. It's an interesting special mode that the Mega Drive had, one which was unique to it, which enhanced the capabilities of the console while also being restricted in what it could do. If you haven't seen my previous video about the Mega Drive's graphical effects and you're unfamiliar with how it all worked, I suggest you go and watch that video first before coming back to this one, as I'll be referring to a number of concepts I talk about in that video as I go through this. Okay, let's get right into it. So I've mentioned before that the Mega Drive had a total of 512 colours, of which a maximum of 64 could be displayed on screen at once, assigned into 4 palettes of 16 colours each. While it's easier to explain that way, technically it's not entirely correct. That 64 colour limit is actually 61 colours, because one colour in each palette is assigned to be transparent, usually position 0 in each palette, although one of these is visible as the solid background colour. This was so that objects could have defined shapes instead of displaying on the screen inside weird boxes. Because remember, these consoles worked using square-shaped tiles, so pixels that were set to that specific colour would be completely transparent on the screen. So that means 61 colours is the maximum that can be on screen at once. Or is it? In my previous video, I covered one way the Mega Drive could increase its on-screen colours, and that was using raster effects to swap the colour palette partway down the screen. But there was another way to do so, which not only increased the on-screen colours, but also effectively increased the total number of colours available as well, and that was the shadow and highlight mode. What this did was allow developers to specify parts of the background or sprites as being darker or brighter, which, theoretically at least, increased the available colours to 1536, and the maximum on-screen colours to 192. Although in practice, it wasn't quite that amount, as there will be duplicate colours that appeared in shadow or highlight mode that were also present in the standard mode. Once you remove the duplicates, it was more like 1024 total colours with 128 possible on screen, but that's still better than it normally would be. But either way, it worked by modifying the base set of 64 colours from 512. It halved the original colour value to get the shadow, or doubled the original colour value to get the highlight. The shadow and highlight mode functioned in conjunction with the priority settings. The way it did this, however, and what kind of effect was created, was different depending on if it was applied to backgrounds or sprites. We'll look at both, but let's start with backgrounds, as that's probably a bit simpler. When talking about backgrounds, at a basic level, shadow and highlight mode will toggle everything that's set to low priority to be shadowed, so they will display in a darker shade than usual. If you want the backgrounds displaying in normal colours with this mode turned on, they need to be set to high priority. The entire plane can be set, but individual tiles on the plane can also be set, and setting a plane or tiles to high priority effectively cancels the shadows so they appear as normal. Note I said normal here, not highlighted. What these high priority tiles are displaying is what the game would look like without shadow and highlight mode turned on. This is because highlight cannot be applied to backgrounds, only shadow can be. So any games that look like they are highlighting parts of the background are actually shadowing everything else on the screen except those brighter parts, which are displaying as normal. In this example of Castlevania Bloodlines, plane A, or the foreground plane, is low priority, but has been set up to have a number of tall vertical columns or tiles set to high priority. These are therefore unaffected by the shadow, and the effect is completed by using line scrolling to tilt them diagonally. Shadowing could even be combined with raster effects. In this case, in Mega Turrican, instead of swapping the colour palette partway down the screen, like many other games did to simulate this kind of effect, it's using shadowing instead to make the underwater area darker. I couldn't make a video on this subject without mentioning Vector Man, a game that's well known for its use of shadow and highlight mode. In this level, we see it using a combination of the previous two examples for the underwater area, swapping to shadowing using a raster effect, but creating beams of non-shadowed light with high priority tiles, and tilting them with line scroll. This is what it looks like without the line scroll creating the tilt, and this is what it looks like with shadow and highlight mode disabled. You might have noticed in these examples so far that the sprites are also shadowed in the darker areas, along with the backgrounds. This is because the sprites in these cases are also set to low priority. When they move into an area that is not shadowed and rendering in normal colors, they too display in normal colors, just like the low priority backgrounds. If the sprites are set to high priority though, like what we see here in Ranger X, they completely ignore the shadow and highlight mode and appear as normal. So it really depended on what kind of effect the developer wanted to achieve. This technique was sometimes used to add emphasis, such as darkening a low priority background to make high priority sprites more visible and prominent, such as this text in Mortal Kombat 3. Going back to Vector Man, this level also uses shadow and highlight mode, this time to make dark areas inside caves. Unlike the previous example, where Vector Man was a low priority sprite so was affected by the shadows, in this case he's a high priority sprite, and therefore unaffected. What the game is doing here to make him darker inside the caves is completely swapping his color palette. You can see when he moves from a light area into a dark area, or vice versa, it's not a gradual process of changing color. He just instantly switches once he reaches a certain point. In fact, you can stand about halfway between a light and a dark area, but his body is still fully one color or the other. If you turn off shadow and highlight mode, he still changes color when he moves between areas, so the game is programmed to swap his color palette whenever he passes certain trigger points in the level. There was probably a reason why they needed to make his sprite high priority in this level, but this is a pretty clever workaround and also results in a more drastic shift in color. One of the Mega Drive's Japanese exclusives, Battle Mania 2, has an interesting implementation of sprite priorities with shadow and highlight mode in the first level. Here, the red background color and other objects in the background, like the moon, are low priority, and the foreground building is high priority. With the mode enabled, it darkens just this background while leaving the rest of the scenery as is. Most of the sprites are also high priority, except the game is also cleverly creating a reflection of the player character in the windows behind them. It's doing this by placing an identical sprite there at a slight offset, which is set to low priority, so it is shadowed like the background is, making it look like a reflection. This approach has the added benefit of this reflection sprite disappearing behind the walls between the windows due to it being a lower priority, so it only shows up when the player actually passes in front of the windows, making it look like there's a real reflection happening. By the way, if you're enjoying this content and would like to see more of it, it'd be awesome if you could subscribe. Okay, let's keep going. So that just about covers backgrounds, but it doesn't end there. The sprites themselves could also have their own shadow and highlight, independent of the background. And yes, unlike backgrounds, highlights could actually be applied to sprites. However, using this mode with sprites was a bit more complex and esoteric than backgrounds, and didn't function quite like how you might have expected. So, we know the Mega Drive used 4 palettes of 16 colours each, with the first colour of one palette usually assigned to the background, and the first colour of each of the others usually assigned to be transparent. There were 2 other special colours though. Those colours were position 14 and 15 of palette 3, or in other words, the final 2 available colours. If you want to use hexadecimal, they would be positions E and F. When shadow and highlight mode was enabled, these colours became the sprite's highlight and shadow colours respectively. Position 14 was highlight, and position 15 was shadow. It didn't actually matter what colour these were set to in this context, they would always be highlight and shadow when the mode was turned on. So any part of the sprite that used position 14 would be a highlight, and any part of it that used position 15 would be a shadow. In my previous video, I covered how the Mega Drive usually used dithering to fake transparency, but this was another, somewhat more convincing way it could do it, because this effectively turned the background behind the affected sprite pixels darker or brighter. It's still not actual transparency like the Super Nintendo could do. After all, it's not doing any colour averaging and it couldn't make transparent colours, it's just changing colours that are already there to be darker or brighter. So, although limited, it must be said it looks a lot better and a lot more believable than dithering under the right circumstances. This was often used to create actual character shadows, like this example in Mortal Kombat 3. The shadows are sprites, so they're purely made up of the colour at position 15 of palette 3, in this case it's grey, which turns into a transparent looking shadow when the mode is enabled. It should be noted that you can't get a double shadow by doing the sprite and the background, they'll both just end up the same colour and effectively cancel each other out. Taking another look at Ranger X, we see the mode being used again in this level with these spotlights. These spotlight beams are low priority sprites, set to use the colour at position 14 of palette 3 this time, the highlight colour, which is green. When shadow and highlight mode is enabled, the screen darkens except for the light beam, which changes from green to highlight, creating the spotlight effect. However, even though it's using the highlight colour, because the screen has been darkened, it's turning the pixels behind it back to their original colours, rather than the brighter highlight colours. If we go back to Mega Tarrakan, we can see an example of an actual highlight with this light beam on this boss. In this case, the screen does not get darkened first, it's displaying in normal colours. The light beam is a sprite that is set to use the colour at position 14 of palette 3, which is dark brown, which turns into a highlight when the mode is enabled. You might notice that when the beam passes over the player or the other projectiles it's firing, it doesn't highlight them. It's only ever highlighting the background behind it. In fact, these other sprites are displaying over the top of it. This is a limitation of using shadow and highlight on sprites, as it only affects the sprite it's applied to, and it'll only ever affect the background pixels behind it, not any other sprites, regardless of their priority. If a shadow or highlighted sprite passes over another sprite, one of them will appear over the top of the other, depending on which one is the higher priority. If the shadowed or highlighted sprite is the one on top, it'll actually completely cancel out the other sprite's affected pixels, and just show the shadowed or highlighted background pixels behind it. This is something that emulators can sometimes get wrong, as they might incorrectly apply shadow or highlight to other sprites. Sometimes, limitations like this actually come in handy. For example, these character portraits in Virtual Fighter 2 that I showed earlier. It's actually using both highlight and shadow at the same time here, which was extremely rare to see. There are sprite tiles around the characters' heads making up the box and shadow, which are set to use colour 14 and colour 15 of palette 3 respectively. Both of these colours are set to black in the actual palette. With shadow and highlight mode enabled, they do their thing, and now it looks like the highlight box has a shadow. The character portraits, however, which are also sprites, are a higher priority than these tiles, so they appear on top, and as you can see, are unaffected by the shadow and highlight mode. They even fade in and out so you can briefly see the full highlight box behind them. Haunting starring Poltergeist is another rare game to use both shadow and highlight. Poltergeist's outfit is made up of colour 14 and 15 of palette 3, which are pink and black respectively, which turn into highlight and shadow once the mode is enabled. The game is pulling a bit of an optical illusion here, because it kinda looks like his green head is also transparent, but it's not. The illusion is a result of his eyes and that black mark on his head also using the shadow colour, so these are shadowed as well. In addition to this, the game uses a dithering effect when he's entering objects. Another creative use is this environment in Rystar. Those light beams aren't the same technique we saw earlier in Castlevania or Ranger X, where it's using high priority tiles on the background plane to create them. The beams are actually sprites, set to use the colour at position 14 in palette 3, which is light blue. The sprites are also low priority, so they appear behind the player sprite. So, with shadow and highlight mode turned on, the screen darkens except for these sprites. But hang on, how is Rystar being shaded in the dark areas and highlighted when he moves into the light beams? Didn't I just say that couldn't happen with sprites? Yeah, that's still the case here. If you look closely, it's pulling the same trick we saw Vector Man doing earlier, and changing his colour palette when he moves in and out of the light, just with sprites as the light source this time. And Rystar is a higher priority, so he appears in front. The colour change is more subtle this time though, making it genuinely look like it's being shaded by the shadow and highlight mode when he's in the darker areas. On the subject of Vector Man, I'll just briefly return to it one more time in case you were wondering at this point if that muzzle flash, how his body lights up like that when he fires his weapon, is done with a highlight. The answer is, no, it's not. Highlight or shadow can't actually make the sprite's colours brighter or darker. All it can do is highlight or shadow the pixels behind it. What's actually going on here for this effect is also just a brief palette swap. One more application of the shadow and highlight mode was to create high quality still images, with Toy Story being perhaps the most well-known example. A video on Game Hut, which I'll link in the description, done by one of the actual developers behind the game, goes into detail on exactly how they achieved this, but in a nutshell, the pictures are made up by combining parts of plane A, parts of plane B, and parts of the sprite plane, and using shadow and highlight mode to create more colours than would otherwise be possible. This is what the images would look like without shadow and highlight mode, so you can see the extra colours they managed to squeeze out using this approach does actually make a big difference. So given all of that, and the fact that the mode relied on the use of the priority system, which developers may have wanted to use for other effects, it's understandable why it was used so rarely in commercial games. If you want to know more about how the shadow and highlight mode works on a technical level, I mean at the actual coding level, I'll leave some links in the description to Pixie's retro game dev tutorials. Here's a number of videos on this subject, and they're well worth checking out if you want to go down the rabbit hole. So that's it for this video. Hopefully now you've come away with a good understanding of how this mode worked, what its strengths were, and also what its limitations were. It wasn't something that was used all that often, but it was a unique feature of the Mega Drive, and as always, in the hands of the right developers, some really cool stuff could be done with it. Drop a comment about what you think about Shadow and Highlight mode and how it was used, and feel free to ask about any other effects in games you are curious about, and maybe I can cover them. Give me a thumbs up if you like this video, it really helps a lot, and don't forget to subscribe to stay up to date with my content. Thanks for watching, and see you next time!